Good evening. Good evening, everyone. Hi, how is everyone? Good, great. My name is Derek Harris, and I work in the External Affairs Office at UCLA Engineering as the Assistant Director for Corporate and Alumni Relations. And I want to thank you all for coming out this evening to join our Ronald and Valerie Sugar Distinguished Speaker Series. I would like to thank and acknowledge the team that's here from Northrop Grumman tonight. They will be set up in the lobby during the reception immediately following the event to facilitate any questions that you might have. Northrop Grumman is one of UCLA's top strategic corporate partners, and we are proud and look forward to the growing partnership that we have with them. I just wanted to let you know tonight, for all of our students, the Office of External Affairs is here to serve as a resource for each and every one of you. We do have some upcoming events in the spring for our seniors, especially. Is the class of 2017 in the house tonight? Yeah, make some noise. Make some noise. So I'm sure that you know about a few events, but I just want to go over them. On February 2nd, SWE will host their corporate roundtable event. April 3rd through the 7th, ESUC will host eWeek. April 9th will be engineering open house for our incoming freshman students. So we are looking for undergraduate students to volunteer to kind of set the tone for our incoming freshmen who are still trying to decide if they want to go here. And if they have decided, make sure that they actually do go here. On Friday, April the 7th, we will have our senior class campaign kickoff. And at that time, our senior class will go into a campaign to raise money to give back to UCLA Engineering. And the great thing about it is that the senior class committee, which is a committee made up of your peers, will have the opportunity to choose the designation of those funds. On Wednesday, May 31st, for our graduate students, we will have a graduate student dinner to celebrate the accomplishments of our graduate students who are graduating this year. And you'll also have an opportunity to network with our triple degree holders from UCLA Engineering. On Thursday, June 8th, is the culmination of our senior class campaign, which will be our senior class dinner, which is the event of the year. So I hope to see you guys all there for free wine and free food. But if you have any questions about the External Affairs Office and what we're doing to make your experience better here at UCLA Engineering, please feel free to connect with myself or any of my colleagues in the room. We all have on a little blue badge, so if you can't find us, that's how you can identify us. At this time, I would like to remind you that this event is being recorded and live streamed, so we're going to ask that you please silence your cell phones or put them on vibrate. If you need to get up to go to the restroom, that is fine, but please try to make your movement as minimum as possible. So I'm going to wait for everyone to go ahead and put their cell phones on vibrate and silent. Okay. And also at the end of the event, we will have a Q&A portion. There will be two microphones, one in each aisle. So we're going to ask that you please get up and wait in line. Please wait your turn. Please do not interrupt anyone that's speaking. We want everyone to have an opportunity to speak and interact with our distinguished speaker this evening and also our distinguished host. So I think those are all the housekeeping rules. At this time, I would like to invite our Ronald and Valerie Sugar Dean of UCLA Engineering, Jayathi Murthy, to the podium.
Thank you, Derek. My name is Jayathi Murthy. I'm the Dean of Engineering here, the Ronald and Valerie Sugar Dean of the Henry Samuele School of Engineering and Applied Science. And I wear all of those labels really proudly. And so I'm absolutely delighted to welcome Ron Sugar to this event today. This is really the second program in the inaugural year of the Ronald and Valerie Sugar Distinguished Sugar Speaker Series. And so I'm delighted to see so many students here in the audience. And I know that we've got a wonderful evening of conversation in store. I want to tell you a little bit about the series itself and our speaker today. Ron Sugar is one of the school's most distinguished and accomplished alumni. And most prominently, he was the chairman of the board and the CEO of Northrop Grumman Corporation. And Ron and his wife, Valerie, have been generous supporters of our school and of all our faculty and students. How did this series come about? I started here about a year ago, and very soon after I started, Ron and I had this conversation about our students and what makes a complete education for them. And he suggested that, in fact, a distinguished speaker series would be one of the things that we would want to think about. And indeed we did, and less than a year later, here we all are kicking this thing off. So I think if you're looking to understand what a career in the aerospace and defense industry would be, Ron's absolutely the perfect person to tell you about it. Before we jump into that, I want to say a few things about what's happening in the school itself. I know that a number of you know this. The school's growing. We're going to be adding 50 faculty and 1,000 students on top of the existing 180 or so faculty and 5,500 students. So we're growing quite significantly. And we've been thinking about where to put the students and faculty. And of course, one of the areas that's of deep interest to us is the aerospace and defense industry, because sitting as we do in Southern California, that's clearly an important area for us. And there are so many exciting things, so many areas of research and teaching that flow from that community. And so I'm very excited about the discussion that's going to happen today. I want to say a little bit about our program this evening. As I mentioned when I was starting off, Ron's been a leader in the aerospace and defense industries for decades. And from 2003 until his retirement in 2010, he was the chairman and CEO of Northrop Grumman. And during his tenure, Northrop Grumman grew to be one of the world's largest aerospace and defense companies, with 120,000 employees and $35 billion in annual revenue. Right? Today, Ron is a director on several corporate boards and an advisor to several investment firms. He's also a trustee of, dare I say it, USC, right? A member of UCLA Anderson School of Management Board of Visitors. He serves on our Dean's Executive Board as well. He's a director of the Los Angeles Philharmonic Association, a director of the Alliance for College-Ready Public Schools, and the National Trustee of the Boys and Girls Clubs of America. Ron holds a bachelor's, master's, and doctoral degrees from UCLA Engineering. He's a member of the National Academy of Sciences, and he has received the UCLA Engineering Alumnus of the Year Award. And like many of you here, Ron actually grew up in Los Angeles, and he graduated from a public high school just down the road on 405, as I understand it. Leading tonight's conversation is a fellow UCLA Engineering alum and distinguished aerospace and defense executive as well, Joanne McGuire. Now, Joanne is no slouch herself. So Joanne retired as Executive Vice President of Lockheed Martin Space Science Systems Company in May 2013, after nearly 7 years as its leader. She has a long list of honors, including one to be awarded next month, the 2017 UCLA Engineering Alumna of the Year Award. So you're certain to hear about the award and about Joanne in the next few weeks. So there you have it. We've got two wonderful, distinguished leaders of the aerospace and defense community. And so we've got a beautiful conversation coming up. I know I'm just very excited. Welcome to both of you, and we're ready to go.
Mike's live.
Mark.
I'm Joanne and he's Ron.
We didn't have a big budget for this series, so they got me to do this.
Well, Ron, let me run through a set of questions with you. And Nathan, you'll keep us on track for time, because I do want to leave plenty of time for questions from the audience. Dean Murthy mentioned in her opening remarks that you and your wife Valerie made a major gift to UCLA Engineering, which helped create this series. Can you expand a little bit on her comments about why you and Valerie thought an event and series like this was an important one to create?
Well, first of all, thank you, Joanne. But you should know Joanne is one of the towering figures of the aerospace industry. She ran the largest space and missile business in the industry. Northrop was not quite as large as what she was running, but it was pretty impressive, and it's an honor to work with you here tonight.
Look,
we started out as pretty poor kids in modest conditions, the south side of L.A., public high school, went to junior high school, transferred here, got into UCLA, got a scholarship to come here, which allowed me to actually afford to live in the dorms, and went on to get a couple more degrees. And it just seemed like it would be really a neat thing to do, looking back, and this is about 50 years ago that we came here. It would be a nice thing to do would be to help the school out and kind of close the circle, because if I think about it, UCLA made such an enormous difference in my life and in my wife's life, certainly in our careers, but more importantly, our lives as well. So it seemed like a good opportunity, and we did the math, and we figured it was a very large return on investment for UCLA if you take what we donated divided by the $3,000 scholarship we got. On the other hand, I did an ROI calculation on my experience, and it was infinite. So I figure we're still ahead of the game. So, but going to the question you asked, Joanne, I thought it was interesting every now and then to be able to hear from people who had actually gone off beyond where I was and hear what their adventure was, and they come back and tell us. And wouldn't it be interesting if we could share sort of campfire stories with all of you who are at the very beginnings of your career and you're getting ready to set foot out and do other amazing things, and have an opportunity to hear a couple of life stories. Your life stories will not be the same. You'll do different things than Joanne or I or others have done, but perhaps there'll be some interesting lessons in there and some things you can ask and questions that we can help you with. And from my perspective, it's fun to do that and fun to see if we can be of some assistance to you. We've had some successes. I've had some successes. I've also made a lot of mistakes. And I think sharing both of them candidly can be helpful to others.
I think, we were chatting just before we came up here and observed that the vast majority of you in the audience were born like in the mid-90s. which I think both Ron and I were pretty far along in our careers at that point. So your immediate reaction might be, well, how is your experience relevant to what my experience is going to be? And I think one of the interesting things about engineering is that even though the problems are different, the approaches and the lessons that you learn, I think, tend to repeat themselves. They're kind of like the lessons of history in that regard. Ron, I'm going to ask you a question about role models and maybe an interaction with a role model that really influenced who and where you are today. Are there any specific role models from industry or academia that inspired you, and who, how, when, why?
Well, a lot of them. By the way, role models, and I hate to say anti-role models too. Mm-hmm. People who I kind of said, you know, I don't think I want to be like that. And so I won't share those people with you by name. but there's lessons learned from all sorts of role models. In my education growing up, there was a couple of teachers who took some special interest in me and gave me some additional attention and some additional extra credit assignments. I remember back in the fifth grade, and I remember once in the seventh grade, ninth grade, 11th, 12th grade. And those people were really great people because they weren't paid a ton of money. And they had to deal with, you know, probably 150 kids in their various classes during the course of the year. But the fact that they took extra attention, I think, now that I reflect on it, I didn't deserve it. It wasn't something I was entitled to, but they did. And they were good people. And so I thought it'd be really cool one day to be able to try and do that for others as well along the way. In business, one of my role models was Ed Dunford. And John and I both benefited by his. He was the president of TRW, where we both worked, but earlier in the days when we were in the space and missiles business down here in El Segundo, Redondo Beach area, he was a role model. He was a special guy. He was someone who kind of looked after me. He actually hired me into the company, and he took a chance on me, and I didn't get offers from other parts of TRW when I applied. He said, "I'm going to take a chance," and put me in a totally different area than that which I was originally qualified to work in. I was more of a system engineer, and he was working in electronics, and he thought maybe it'd be nice to have somebody with that background in electronics. The electronics people looked at me like, you know, you're not from here, are you? I'm not from here. But the experience of actually having to go out of my comfort zone was good for me. And he kind of nurtured me along the way and gave me a couple of good lessons and a couple of, frankly, good teaching moments when I kind of got off the rails a little bit. And that was helpful. And I will say that over the years, he kind of watched after me. He moved on to the corporate headquarters of TRW, which was in Cleveland. And when he was going to retire, there was a question about who would succeed him and what would be the chain of command. And he made an interesting suggestion. He said, why don't we put the guy who's the chief financial officer in my job as president, and why don't we bring this rocket science guy from Space Park in Redondo Beach and make him the chief financial officer? And everybody thought he was nuts. And there was like this pause. I'm told this. I wasn't in the room at the time in the executive suite. It was sort of like this long pause. And everybody was thinking, that's the stupidest thing we've ever heard. What's the boss going to say? The chairman says, that's a brilliant idea. Let's do it. So I get a call the next day from the chairman of the board. And he says, I want you to come back to Cleveland. I want to talk about a position with you. And I said, oh, shit. Because he never called me before. Yeah. Went back. Had the discussion. I called my wife, and she says, so? I said, well, he wants me to be the chief financial officer. And she says, but you're totally unqualified, dear.
You know, he's got your back.
For those of you who have significant others, you understand they do speak truth to you sometimes. And I said, but he says it's going to be a great job. She says, well, great. Well, you'll get to keep doing it from Los Angeles, right? You don't have to move to Cleveland, do you? I said, yeah, I think I'm going to have to do this job out of Cleveland. And she said, well, what are they going to pay you? I said, I didn't ask him. She said, this better be a good job. Anyway, so we've all had mentors along the way.
We've all had those, for sure. When you graduated from UCLA, and remind me, did you go straight through, all the way through to a PhD?
I did, although I worked full-time while I was in the graduate program.
In the graduate program.
Full-time in both, actually.
Okay. What were your initial career goals, and maybe what drew you to the aerospace industry?
So as a kid, growing up here in Southern California, I was about 9 years old, and the Russians launched the Sputnik satellite. And I have to always calibrate. There's a few people in this audience that know what that is. Not everybody may remember what it was. Probably most of you don't actually remember because you weren't alive. But there was a Cold War between the United States and the Soviet Union. And there was a little bit of a race about who was going to get first to space, who was going to build missiles first. And this was sort of a life and death struggle between two major superpowers. And the Soviets stunned the world by being the first to launch a satellite that orbited the Earth. And it was called Sputnik. And this thing was like the shot heard around the world, literally. And it created a high level of alarm initially in this country, and then a constructive response, which was, hey, we are being beaten by this, what we thought was a backward country in science and technology. We need to get it together for a lot of reasons, including national survival. But, oh, by the way, a lot of other good reasons, too, like improving our standard of living, quality of life. So what we need to do is make sure people are doing much more in science and technology. We've got to stimulate the next generation of kids to do this. We've got to add science and math programs to our junior high schools, our high schools, our grade schools. We've got to give some additional funding to universities. We've got to have a national science foundation, et cetera. So this created an enormous buzz. So I'm 9 years old, and I don't know what all this means, except it sounded really cool, and there's rockets going off and stuff flying around. And like, it would be okay to actually study math, and I was pretty good at math, and I looked at a number of potential opportunities for myself. I love music. My dad says, we don't have any money, you're going to starve. So do math, because at least you can become an engineer. And it was kind of fun. It was interesting, and I got to do something I was reasonably good at, and it sounded to me like that was something that the nation would value.
And what kept you in the aerospace industry, Ron?
I think that's a good...
There must have been downturns.
There were a few downturns, like not long after I got in. In 1969, there was... What kept me in was not getting laid off.
Okay.
That was a good thing, because we do have some cycles, as you know. But what was interesting is that I was able to continue to learn and grow and do things and feel appreciated. And I got to work with really smart people. And I got to work with people who had a fairly high sense of patriotism for the nation, for feeling that what they were doing was not just a job, but it was actually important and it really mattered. It made a difference. And my view was for probably 5 or 10 years out of college to be paid actual money to do something that I used to have to do for free as a student. And I didn't have homework at night. I mean, it didn't get any better. So, anybody worry about a test coming up? So I'm just wondering. That's the greatest thing, by the way, when you go out and you get your first job, is you're not, the test is not hanging over your head, you know, for next Friday.
Just a design review.
Yeah. Oh, that's true. We do have those. John did remind me. We do have a few things like design reviews, competitions, have to win programs.
There are occasional deadlines.
That's true.
Can you describe a little bit about the transition that you made from engineer to businessman? What attracted you to management and away from a traditional engineer's purely technical track?
Well, being trained as an engineer, being surrounded by engineers, and believing that we are always much smarter than those other guys who wore suits, you know, that sort of thing.
Right.
That we'd never want to, you know, go to the dark side and be a manager.
Right.
The joke is that, you know, engineers, you can tell an engineer because he looks at his shoes when he talks, right?
An extroverted engineer looks at the other engineer's
shoes. The other engineer's shoes. And they caught me looking at the other guy's shoes occasionally, and they said, this guy has management
potential.
Talent.
He's got potential.
We can work with this guy. We can just get his line of sight up to make eye contact every now and then. What we've got here is a manager, maybe. But I enjoyed the engineering work. It was thrilling. I got to work with smart people. But I then learned that engineering is a team sport. And it's hard to do anything by yourself. If you want just personal aggrandizement, you can sit in a cubicle and try and work on solve the 5-color theorem or the 4-color theorem, something like that, and you can get your name in history books forever. But in engineering, it's a team sport, and it requires people who have multiple skills working together and trying to do fairly significant things. And then I realized that it's kind of analogous to like an orchestra. You know, you could be the best oboist or the best violinist or the best cellist, and that's wonderful, and you should be if you can be, but the orchestra sound is enhanced if you have a pretty decent conductor who can actually conduct the orchestra and get the best out of all the parts and get them to play together and to make a beautiful symphony or a beautiful concerto work. And I was trained in music as a kid, and that I kind of like that. The other thing, which was quite candidly happening, is that engineering is really hard work. I don't know if you guys know that yet, but it's hard. And, you know, and to really get it right, it's hard, it's demanding. And I found it was a lot easier to wander the hallways, talk to people, go to the water cooler, get coffee, how you doing, what's going on? And they said, you know, that's what managers do. I said, I can be a manager. I can be pretty good at it. And, you know, it's like not having to work, and they still pay you. In fact, if you do it well, they pay you a little more. You don't actually have to create anything, you don't have to do anything, but you can just kind of, you know, kibitz and talk. And
so this must have been your early formulation of the management.
Yeah, I thought I was pretty smart. I figured that out.
Yeah. I
didn't realize there was responsibility that went with it, and you actually had to deliver, too. That's the.
So clearly this notion of what you were able to do, the rewards associated with being able to orchestrate and coordinate a large team of engineers solving a really complex set of problems was intrinsically rewarding. What was most challenging about it for you?
Well, you know, I kind of figured if you could get the project done without the people, it would be even easier. Because you begin to realize that people are not always going to do what you tell them to do, and they are people, and they're all different. And so how do you motivate? You've decided that you're going to build this magnificent thing, this rocket or this engine or this spacecraft. And you say, okay, gang, you've been assigned to me. Now build it. And they're going to say, yeah, right. And then you realize there's a whole question of motivation and engagement and communication and developing a sense of shared purpose, and shared mission. And how do you make it worth their while to invest themselves emotionally and intellectually in the pursuit? And to put in extra nights and weekends, And it's not just to aggrandize you as the boss who gets the award when it's all finished. So that becomes an interesting challenge. And as a very young supervisor, about 6 or so years into my career, I got to supervise a group of people, all of whom were at least 10 years older than me. And I found that I had extraordinarily no skills in leading, managing, or motivating. And that turned out was going to be a problem in my objective of where I was going to go in life. And so you have to kind of figure out, okay, reset. This is a team sport. How do you get the team to want to play? And how do you get the whole team to want to win?
Cool. So fast forward a few years, and you're chairman and CEO of Northrop Grumman Corporation, a $35 billion enterprise with 120,000 employees, solving some of the world's toughest security problems. So you have multiple stakeholders there.
Yeah.
You have multiple major kinds of programs going on.
Yeah.
You're really a global company. What did you find most challenging about that position?
A lot. Well, you know, one thing, you at $35 billion, you do the math. So you come home on Friday night and your wife says, "Well, how'd it go?" I said, it's pretty good. So did you do what you had to do this week? I said, well, you know, to maintain $35 billion a year of sales, we had to bring in $700 million in new orders this week. And she says, well, did you do it? I said, I don't know. I hope so. She says, well, you know, if you don't do that a few weeks in a row, your sales are going to go down and you're not going to be. I said, yeah, I know. What's for dinner? So that was one challenge. Other challenges. So you have these 120,000, you know this, Joan, you had thousands of people, tens of thousands of people too. And it's like 10 o'clock at night, you know. What are they doing? Is there somebody that's doing something that's going to cause a problem? Is there somebody that's leaking classified information? Is there somebody who's doing something to a competitor? Is somebody who's doing something, you know, somebody who's talking to the Wall Street Journal that, you know, they shouldn't be? Or somebody's filing a whistleblower suit about something they imagine might have been happening in the organization. And so you worry about that. You worry about making sure the products you're making are really going to work, because the lives of the young men and women in our services and, frankly, our nation depend upon the stuff working. So you've taken a contract. You have a multi-billion dollar contract to build a significant space system or an aircraft or a B-2 bomber. Or in our case, a nuclear aircraft carrier, it's got to work. And if you're an engineer and you know the complexity that goes into any one of these systems, anything, any little thing that goes wrong can cause a problem. And it wasn't anybody's intention to do that, but stuff does happen, right? So you do worry about, is there something that could go wrong that could cost lives or cause a problem in combat? Other things you worry about. The political dimension of a company of this scale, and it's true of all companies today, but certainly in our industry, is significant. We operated in all the states in the union in 24 countries. We are the largest employer in 4 states because of our big shipyards and what have you. And you get a lot of input from the political leaders about what they want their agenda to be. For example, our friends in Mississippi, where we had the largest shipyard, wanted to make sure we employed lots of people in Pascagoula, and the 2 senators there were on us all the time. And often their desires for what should happen were not consistent with what was either the right thing to do for our shareholders or the right thing to do for our contract with the Navy. And so you found yourself at tension and at odds. And you found the political dimensions to our game, where you might have, let's say, the F-35 fighter, which we worked on jointly with Lockheed, very important new weapon system for this nation and our allies. A lot of challenges. All these systems have these challenges. And now, again, a round of political pressure on the cost of the system and dealing with what is, for engineers, an irrational environment. Engineers can measure things. They can quantitate things. They can deal with rational things. Engineers have a problem dealing with irrational things, which are human emotion, politics, rhetoric, innuendo, and all those things. And yet, those are very important, very material. So lots of things to keep you up at night when you're running a company. Mm.
I'm reminded of a motivational meeting I arranged for my team on DSP. The DSP was an early warning satellite in geostationary orbit, and it had infrared sensors so that it could detect any time a missile was launched. And it actually had really excellent detectors and optics, and so it got to the point where they could detect, you know, very short-range missiles, cruise missiles, and those kinds of things. So the colonel came to give the team a pep talk, and he said, you know, what you guys are working on is so vitally important to the Air Force and to the world, and certainly to this nation, because if you don't get it right, people will die. And I said, okay, that's impactful. I'm not sure it was quite the... So, I mean, probably the first time I thought really that hard about what the significance was of the things that we did. I mean, we like to talk in flowery terms about making the world safe for democracy and those kinds of things. But this gentleman had a real sense of purpose, and he had friends and buddies that were scattered across the world in not very safe places, and really could kind of articulate, you know, the significance of what we were doing in very graphic terms. Let's change gears and talk a little bit about technology. What advances in technology you think are changing the focus of the defense industry? How do you think, you know, what are some of the trends in technology that are going to be impactful for the defense industry? And maybe more broadly, how do you think they're impacting the U.S. in relation to our friends and allies and adversaries around the globe?
No, that's a good question. You know, it used to be back from World War II into the early days of the Korean War and the Cold War that the technology that was being advanced through military research, development, and investment often was leading the civilian side. And then there was kind of a turning point probably in the 70s, I would guess, where we started to see increasing amount of development in the commercial world, which began to lead the military world, not just in the United States, other places. And today you have things playing back. But if you stand back and say, what are the things that have changed warfare in the last, say, 10 or 20 years? It used to be we had combat aircraft with pilots in them. Today we have more drone operators in the United States Air Force than we have combat pilots. And we have increasing uses of autonomy in these aircraft. We see increasing use of surveillance, reconnaissance, remote sensing, communications. Those sorts of things have really taken over from the days when you had massive tank battles with 4,000 or 5,000 tanks facing each other, say, in some battle. If you think about going forward, though, I think what's happening in the civilian world is going to affect here very much. Clearly, artificial intelligence, by whatever name, whether you call it machine learning, AI, what have you, is going to continue to be an extraordinarily important vector in the military world for national security. It's going to be in everything in our life, whether it's Alexa or Siri, whether it's the car that you're going to drive in about 4 or 5 years, or it's not going to drive, it's going to drive you in 4 or 5 years down the highway. The jobs that are going to be disintermediated, including people who are smart, who sit in front of computer screens, who have generally rule-based jobs, are going to potentially be disintermediated, not just factory workers who are disintermediated by robots. So you're going to see a considerable amount of technology coming in that dimension. Advanced materials are going to make a big difference going forward. I think just the concept of integration of forces and activity, the use of cyber technology, cyber weapons, is already making a huge difference. I mean, there's nobody alive now, today, this moment, that doesn't understand that there's something going on with this cyber stuff with Russia. And the Stuxnet stuff of a few years ago, which was denied being, actually had some potential impact. People don't realize that when the Russians invaded Georgia, Georgian Republic, for 24 hours before that, they basically launched through their gangster affiliates, a complete takedown of the system of IT for that country. So by the time they moved in with their tanks, there was no command and control system. There was no way to know what was going on. And so they basically, they talked that the kinetic attack, that is when you actually have tanks and planes, was pretty clean because the cyber attack basically took down the whole system. You're going to see that increasingly used. And there are probably 5, 6, 7 countries in the world today that have very, very sophisticated cyber capabilities. Think about the only thing that separates us from the Stone Age is that we have power, we have clean water, we have communications. If that's taken away from us, it changes everything, even if it's for just a period of a few days. Think about the last power outage at your house. So I think these kind of technologies are things that that are going to affect conflicts between nations.
Right. Following up a little bit on the cyber one, I suspect, you were appointed to the National Security Telecommunications Advisory Committee, also known by its acronym NSTAC, during Bill Clinton's administration. Can you share how important that role was and what you feel you were able to accomplish during that time? A little bit about what their mission is.
Yeah, the NSTAC was created when Judge Green disbanded AT&T's monopoly on communications in this country. And this was in the 1980s, so this is like a long time ago. But we don't realize today there was a monopoly in this nation for all of telecommunications. It was AT&T, Ma Bell. It was taken apart. But one of the advantages that existed for the government is one guy the intelligence agencies could go to, which would be the people at AT&T, and say, let's make sure that our telecommunications system is secure, make sure that the bad guys can't bug it, make sure that we can make sure bad guys are used. Then you basically deregulate it. You now have dozens, hundreds of suppliers. So what was felt necessary was to establish this as kind of a way to reconstitute a virtual system. It was interesting. It was nice to have a presidential appointment. I served with many great people. I would have to tell you candidly, I don't think it was that effective. You know, it's not the proudest thing I felt we've ever accomplished as a nation, but it was necessary and it was a learning experience.
You sit on multiple boards. Apple being most notable, as I read through your resume. What would your advice be for those in the room that have entrepreneurial bent and are thinking about starting up their own business?
Well, first of all, I think it's good to have that bent. And the joke is fail early and fail often, is what they say. you don't intentionally want to fail. But you that's wisdom coming to all of you. Been there, done. It's not fun, but the idea of entrepreneurship is being willing to not take the status quo. And say I can make a difference. I can make something happen, and I have a better idea. And then not just sitting there complaining about stuff or whining about it, but actually doing something and taking it on yourself. And not all of us are wired this way, but for those of us that happen to be wired this way, it's a great thing to do. Do it younger, but try and surround yourself with people who kind of know what they're doing, if you can, and find mentors and find people to work with you. It is a jungle out there. One of the great entrepreneurs of our experience in America was a guy named Edison, and he was great, except that he died poor because he basically had almost everything taken away from him by smart lawyers and patent battles and this and that. And he was a bitter, broken guy at the end, but he did add some value to the country. So not all entrepreneurship tails result in being Mark Zuckerberg or Steve Jobs. It's a high-risk, high-reward undertaking. And give it a try. I mean, if this is where you think you want to go, give it a try and test yourself and test the market. And if you fail, candidly figure out what it was that worked, what it was that didn't work, what about you worked, what about you didn't work, and how can you do better on the next thing. I'm working with a couple of entrepreneurs now who are running some very significant companies. One guy, it's his third company, and he failed big in his first company. He kind of had a medium, mediocre run in his second company. His third company is doing really well. Part of that has to do with the fact that he may be in a more fruitful area, but part of it has to do with the fact that he had a couple of cycles of experience, which he was then able to take forward with him.
I think one of the things that I experienced when we were at TRW and then again at Lockheed Martin, as the defense budgets would wax and wane, when they were in their waning periods, we would say, well, maybe there's some commercial ventures we could undertake together. And we would invariably reach out to the engineering workforce and say, who's got some ideas? And there was never a shortage of ideas. Never, ever a shortage of ideas. What was usually missing was, how do we make money at this? How do we take a first mover position and convert that into a sustainable advantage? And so I think the advice that I would have for entrepreneurs in this room is, make sure you surround yourself with people who are skeptical, which probably aren't the first people you want to have around you, but finance people tend to be that way, so go find some people over at the Anderson School.
And, but not the entrepreneurial department, because that's very good. Yeah. It's those people in finance.
But find people who are going to kind of complement you. You don't want to just be strictly a bunch of engineers going at this. You want to get somebody who understands a little bit about maybe marketing, maybe understands a little bit about investment and how you attract investment investors and those kinds of things. So I think that's from my vast years of experience as an entrepreneur, that's what I would share with you as a thought. Nathan, should we how are we doing on time? Is it time for microphones or? Yep. Okay. Let's throw it open and see if anybody is going to be step to one of these microphones on either side and pose a question for Dr. Sugar.
He's actually leaving. He's not going to the microphone. He's had enough.
Hi, so my name is Kash Krishnasby, and I'm a third-year undergrad electrical engineer major. I had two questions, if that's okay. So one question is regarding your early young days, and you mentioned something about, like, you loved music, and you had to get yourself, or your father, or got you in the field of math and learning about, like, technology and stuff for the opportunities. How did you go through the transition of, like, sort of giving up on what you loved at the moment for, like, the sake of getting yourself in the field of opportunities? Like, how did you manage to go through that?
Well, I liked all those things. I also loved to play sports. And, you know, I grew up here in L.A., and I loved the Dodgers, and Vin Scully was my hero. And one day I wanted to be Vin Scully's successor. It's a good thing I didn't plan on that, because I'd be 68 years old by the time the guy retired.
You might get a job tomorrow.
Who knew he was going to be broadcasting for 80 years or something? I think, you know, it's difficult. You know, they talk about, don't ever ruin a kid's dreams. Make sure a kid knows he should follow his dreams no matter what it is, and just follow your dreams. There are others who say that's probably not helpful advice for a lot of kids. You should try and moderate, what are your dreams, what do you like, what are you good at, and what does the world really need? Now, if you decide that you want to live the life of an ascetic hermit and you don't need anything from society or life, then follow your dreams and you will not be unhappy. If you feel like you really want to be successful and you want people to like you and want you and this and all that sort of stuff and make some money, then you want to modify your dreams. How can I take what I like, what I really think I'm good at, and find a problem that can be solved? We talk about silent suffering. You know, there's things that go on out there where if someone could just find a way to solve this problem, and people always know it's a problem, you find a problem. You know, for example, people used to go to banks, and there were like 10 tellers, and there were 10 lines for 10 tellers. And you guys probably don't do this, but when I was, I used to do that, and you'd always stand in the wrong line.
Because
TSA, right, yeah. So Mildred's up ahead of you, and she's got this big problem, and you're in this line, and everybody else is going. So someone came up with the idea with, how about a multiple server single queue? You know, how hard could that be? Well, nobody, that wasn't really something that became real positive until like the 60s. You know, TSA's still got some work to do on that. So by the way, you know, I'm not going to get through my next security thing on time for my airplanes since I said that. They're listening. But find something that really can be neat. You know, in my career, and I think in Joanne's as well, when we went into the companies we were in, we were asked to work on something. Our first assignment wasn't the assignment to save the world from communism. It was to work on some strange, obscure thing, calculating something or redoing some work that was. but do it well, and then try and find out what's the problem that's not been solved that could make a difference. You could put your efforts on any number of things. Why not put your best efforts on something which, if you saved it or solved it, would make a big difference? And that would be my suggestion in that regard. And so that's kind of what I did without thinking about it like that or intuitively. But there was another motivating factor in my case. You know, neither of my parents finished high school. And so I had this thing that would be really cool if I could actually make a living and support my family. So I was kind of driven by where the economics were, too.
Perfect, perfect. And then if that's okay, could I ask another question, too?
Okay, quickly.
My second question is, when you talked about your career at UCLA, you mentioned that you were a full-time student and you had a full-time job as well.
Yeah.
So I'm sure there were a lot of nights, like all-nighters and stressful weeks and like zits and pimples popping out of your face and everything. So my question is, how did you manage to keep yourself, aside from like reaching your ultimate goal and like, you know, the financial freedom and that, how did you keep yourself motivated through all those like hardships while seeing your like buddies just going out every night and like, you know, enjoying their college life while you were there, working full-time, being a full-time student and like going through all the all-nighters?
Well, it helped to be an engineer and therefore not having any personality or being a nerd. I didn't drink. I mean, I probably should have, but I didn't drink a whole lot. And I certainly wasn't doing dope, although some of the kids were doing a lot of dope around me in those days. This was in the 60s and things were starting to change and whatever. Bob Dylan was becoming popular and all this, you know. So I think I had for some reason, and it was programmed by my parents' hardship, that I had to get through and do the most I could as fast as I could, because if I somehow got off the pattern, I would never make it to get my master's. I'd never go back to get a PhD. And so I just kind of put my head down and bore through it. And I ended up with a bachelor's at 19 and a PhD at 22, I think, and which is crazy. And if I had it to do again, I think I probably should have had more self-confidence that I would have found a way to get back and do more. Now, it did turn out that the companies I worked for were, the company I worked for, Aerospace Corporation, was generous in reimbursing this, but they basically said, you have to keep working. So I worked, I think the least I worked in any one semester was 32 hours, but most of the time it was 40 hours. And so you just don't do some other things. Having looked back on all of that, I would also tell you, I still wasted a lot of time. Mm-hmm. It was a lot, I screwed around. I did things I probably shouldn't have done. But you get through it, and then you exhale, and you say, God, I'm glad that's done. No more exams.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Hi, Timothy John again. I had one question that I really wanted to know about, didn't get to ask it. What qualities or abilities do you think are lacking in engineers today?
General question. They don't have personality. They're not in good in sales and marketing. You know.
I think the biggest challenge for engineers early in their career is to have some perspective on other than technical dimensions of the problem. I think you've all been immersed in the technology and the technical aspects of a problem, and when you come out into the real world, you'll find that there are all these other dimensions of the problem. You have to be able to work with other people, and I think more and more, I think the schools and universities have have built experiences for you, provided you with experiences to do more team projects and those kinds of things. But even still, you typically don't have a finance person coming in and pounding on you, or a scheduler coming in and pounding on you. And so having an awareness of the whole team and the dynamic of the whole team, I think, is one of the big challenges for early career engineers, is to gain an appreciation for all those kinds of things.
And that's an experiential thing.
Right.
Because you can't know what you don't know until you get in there, and then you have to be sensitive to it.
Over here.
Hi, my name's Benjamin Bowen. I'm a third-year undergrad student here in electrical engineering. First off, thank you guys both for coming. I really appreciate this. It's great to get a different perspective on everything. We touched a lot about Ron's big accomplishments and everything. I was curious if you could give one small daily habit that's often overlooked that you think is the most important for staying in front of everything in such a high-stakes environment.
Well, I'll give you my view. The most important thing in my life was my family and raising my kids right. When I was a young engineering project manager, probably about 8 or 10 years in, and I realized I had some potential, I went to a retirement party for a very senior executive at Hughes Aircraft Company. And he was being honored and all this kind of stuff. And I said, God, I'd like to be like this guy one day, or half of what this guy was one day. And I went over to him, and because I kind of knew him, but he was like there, and I was like here, right? And I said, congratulations, you know, I just hope I can be like you one day. And he looked at me, the funny look, and he said, you know, I'm pretty successful, but the one thing I regret is that I left my kids in the dust. I didn't expect to get that at all. And I looked at him, and he looked at me, and he said, that's my message to you.
That's a great one.
I said, wow.
That's a great
And so my natural instincts were to be family-oriented and work with my family and my kids, and never forget that ultimately what I'm doing it for is not for me. I'm doing it for my family and for the benefit. And the beautiful thing is that your family, if they know you're behind them and you're working for them, they're working for you too. So when it comes time to call your kids in and say, kiddies, we're moving to Cleveland, Ohio. Are we good to go? That was a very long evening with the family, and there was discussion of this. It's so funny. My son was 14, smart as hell. My daughter was 11 and very smart, but very emotional. My son immediately begins the due diligence process. He wants to know what's the job, where we're going, what are the trade studies, what are my alternatives, what if I don't go? This is really incredible. You know, he went to Princeton, majored in engineering, and he's on Wall Street. So that's his thing. My daughter's reaction was basically to look, and then she just cried. She couldn't stop crying.
My world's coming apart.
She says, and my life is going to change. I said, yeah. So we all did it. We had the big family hug, family cry. I said, is everybody, because if we're not all in this, we're not going to do it. They're like, where are you? We got to go do it, Daddy. You got to go. We're with you. So anyway, so that's more than you wanted to hear, but that's sort of the unhit. You don't see that in my resume anywhere. But when I go to my grave, I won't think about some honor I got from the what's your society. I'll think about my family.
Great. Thank you so much.
Well said. Over here.
Hi. My name is Cheyenne, electrical engineering student. It's a pleasure to be here. Given your level of success, if you could go back, would you do anything differently?
Oh, yeah. I wouldn't make all those mistakes I made. do anything differently. You know, it's hard to know what the alternative future would have been. I'll give you a funny one. You know, I was in junior college, and I tested pretty well, so I just, for the hell of it, I applied to UCLA. I applied to Arizona State. I was in Arizona at the time. I said, I'll apply to Caltech. I'll apply to MIT. I'll apply to Stanford. And I got into all of them. And so, of course, I went to UCLA. And the reason I went to UCLA is because my girlfriend was going to go to UCLA. So, you know, that was what you call a high risk. But it turned out to be a high reward because that gal is my wife, and we've been married 45 years and together 55 years. So it turned out that was a bet that worked out. But, you know, my wife told me one time, she says, you know, if our kids did that, I'd knock their brains out. Why wouldn't they go to? But you know what? It turned out it worked out very well, and UCLA has turned out to be a great experience. So, yeah, I've done a lot of things that I wish I could have done differently, but, you know, they're too numerous to mention.
Yeah, I'll let that one go.
Yeah.
Over here.
Hi, I'm Nicholas. I'm a fourth year electrical engineering student.
Yeah.
And you mentioned two occupational transitions in which you were underqualified for your next job. I wanted to know what qualities or skills helped you adapt for your new job.
Mm. Well, let me just say that there were about six.
Yeah.
For which I
don't
was,
ever remember being qualified.
No,
for the
we were never. No, if you're qualified for your job, it's probably not going to be a stretch or growth for you. And this is something I've learned in my own experience, and then I've learned when I thought about moving many of these thousands of people around and taking them out of their comfort zone and trying to make a judgment: will they succeed? Will they not? Is it more likely than not? And what have you? I think not everyone needs to do this. Nobody wants to do this. A lot of people don't want stress. A lot of people want to do something really well and keep doing it, and be really good at it, and that's okay. And that's okay for them emotionally, and that's okay for the company, because you need people like that, right? In my particular case, I was challenged. I wanted to try new things. I would get bored if I was doing the same thing for too long. And if I saw something that was interesting, It'd be fun to do it. I was asked often to take something out of my comfort zone. That's a term you hear. And I learned pretty early that if I did that, it would be a little bit uncomfortable, for sure. That's what the term means. It would be challenging. I might fail, and I really shouldn't do it if I'm really worried about failing. But I would learn something from it. And it's the old adage, that which does not kill you will make you stronger. You can't do too many of those because eventually the law of averages will catch up with you, right? And you'll be dead. But the biggest thing was doing that CFO job, which was really totally completely out of my comfort zone. I had no training for it at all, and I could have failed. And by the way, I made some mistakes in it, and there were some issues. There were some days when the stock price was doing this and that. And
I remember
CEO,
those, Ron.
Oh, yeah, she remembers those. Yeah, she remembers those. And she says, "Sell Northrop or sell TRW." Yeah, I'm out of here. So anyway, but you just take those risks, and you know it's basically survival of the fittest. You're entitled to nothing. You don't have privilege. You've got to earn what you get, and you've got to be successful. And working in a company, if you have ambition, it's not like a family. It's not unconditional love. Right. If you don't perform, you don't deserve the right to be in the job.
So I always went into jobs that I was unqualified for, leaning strongly on a conviction that I could learn on the fly. And the second one was to be able to figure out who knows what quickly and who you can trust, who you can rely on for what kind of support. And then I think putting yourself out there a bit. Because if you come in as, you know, I'm the new boss, I know it all, that can be kind of off-putting for your team. If you come in into a new assignment and you say, you know, to your colleague or your subordinates, you know, I'm new to this, but it seems to me it's like this. What am I not seeing about this situation? Or tell me what you've learned in your time here, and how can we together be successful? I think you find that most people are incredibly generous when they feel valued.
What's that?
Over here.
Hello, my name is Kyle Johnson. I'm an aerospace engineering student.
Yay, we found one. I thought they were all electrical.
What's wrong with electrical?
Nothing wrong with electrical.
I was wondering what you consider to be the most rewarding experience of your professional career.
Whoa. most rewarding experience. Well, maybe when we got the Milstar satellite launched and it worked.
Yeah, I was going to geek out too. Mine was Chandra X-ray Observatory.
Your Chandra X-ray Observatory, you know, looking back into the history of the universe. Yeah, it's when you work on something for years and years, it's challenging. You take all kinds of shots in the chip and you hit in the mouth and a lot of crap and the budgets and this and that. And then you finally get it to, and it works and the mission succeeds. So I think when you know you get it and it works and everything you've done mattered and you got it right despite what you had to put into it and all the blood and guts out there, that's and you can see that on a small scale, medium scale, large scale. When you operate in a large company with large numbers of people on multi-year projects, they tend to be big successes or big failures. Rockets do blow up. Satellites don't always work. You know, we launched an amphibious assault ship, which was not ready for sea, and we heard about it from the Marines. But on the other hand, when the aircraft carriers work, they love that. So success helps.
It's a geeky thing.
Hi, my name's Ed. I'm a second year aerospace engineer. So Ron, you mentioned your time when you were just starting out as a manager and how you found it challenging to motivate people.
Yeah.
What were some of the things that you eventually found out that worked in terms of motivating people? And did those skills scale up when you went to work at Northrop?
Yeah, they did. So when you are an extraordinarily capable individual performer and you're spotted and then they move you into a supervisory role, what you think is just because you're the smartest kid in the class that you should be the best manager, it turns out it's a very different skill set that's needed you were given the opportunity because people saw that you were smart and you kind of saw which way to go, but the skills to actually motivate others to do it are very different. I was in a position in my life where my first managerial assignment was a little rocky, to say the least. I was also having my first kid. And so I was taking this course in basic supervisory management, which my boss thought I should have because I really needed it. And my wife took me to this class called basic raising of kids.
Parenting.
It was called STEPS, systematic training for effective parenting. So, you know, I'm going, you know, two nights to this thing, two nights to that thing. And after about 2 weeks, a funny thing occurred to me. This is the same class. It's the same class. You know, so in the management class, they're saying, you know, to motivate your people, don't just yell at them and tell them what they're doing wrong. Make sure when they do something good, they get rewarded. So in the parenting class, they said, you know, don't just yell at your kids and tell them don't. Catch them at being good. I said, wait a minute, that's the same thing. And so I began to realize it was just like a fortuitous thing that my first supervisory assignment and my first parenting situation were very similar. So I think what you have to realize is that being the smartest kid in the class does not make you a successful executive. What makes you a successful executive is that you figure out how to lead and motivate others. You know, and my philosophy of leadership is you surround yourself with the best people. You figure out where you want to go. You surround yourself with the best people. Okay, you empower them. You trust them. You share with them everything you know. You work for them when they have things that need to be done that are blocking them from getting their jobs done. And when you're successful, you give them the credit because they did the work. And that's such a obvious thing to say, what I just said, but that took me, you know, a decade to learn. And it works. That's what leadership is.
Great. Thank you.
Over here.
I had that exact same question, so I'm good.
Okay. All right.
Same answer.
Go ahead.
Good evening. My name is Mathieu Lupu, first year undergrad engineering student. I was wondering, being in charge of companies who are so large and who work with the government and so many procedures are involved, how do you stay ahead of the game, and how do you decide what risks to take?
Well, let me take a shot. I think Joanne can probably even elaborate more. So it's complicated. The federal acquisition regulation makes the U.S. tax code look simple. That's the laws that you have to apply when you buy a weapons system. The whole set of military standards that apply to everything that you do. There's a military standard for everything, from a nuclear bomb. There's actually a military standard for making a fruitcake. There's a specification of a military standard for a fruitcake in terms of how large the cherry should be, how large the raisins
walnuts,
should be, the walnuts, what percentage of sugar, what percentage of flour. And if you don't comply with that, you're in violation and you're subject to defective pricing laws and all kinds of things. So the answer is you've got to create a structure of a system and a process with people who understand these processes and follow the processes with discipline. And it's nice to have people who like to wing it and people who like to play pirates, but you can't do that in any large technologically complex organization.
Yeah, I would say there's I think two dimensions to it. The one that Ron mentioned, which is you have to have a system in place where you have expertise and that expertise is accessible by people. So that there's, you know, if you call a hotline and say, I don't know how to deal with this situation. I have a supplier overseas and I have to get these products in, and we'll hook you up with the import-export people and they'll walk you through the whole process. The second piece of it, which is a lot more nebulous, but equally as important, especially in a large organization, is you have to establish a culture. And you have to establish a culture where it's okay to not know and where it's okay to screw up, but you should be the person that's told somebody you screwed up. That it's, obviously there are some things that are mortal sins and venial sins in the hierarchy of screw-ups, but I think you really need to have an environment where people recognize that it's important to get it right, and then you need a supporting system that shows them how they can access the know-how to get it right. And you can lay on all the, you know, compliance documentation and people, you know, taking annual, signing annual certifications that they understand their obligations and all that. But if you haven't told people and rewarded people and caught people in the act of doing the thing right, doing the right things and doing them well, you can find yourself very exposed to we have these books and we do it all by the book, but there's really not any impetus within the workforce to recognize that this is something we value and it's important to get right.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Also, I would tell you, yeah, you know, when I was at TRW, I thought we were extremely bureaucratic and rule-bound, and then I went to work at Lockheed Martin, the world's largest, you know, the U.S. government's largest federal contractor, and I discovered what their level of risk tolerance was, which was, you know, kind of unmeasurable. Yeah. And you know, the joke around the aerospace industry was TRW stood for turkeys running wild. Right. So we would take risks that the number one or number two contractors would never take because they are under a microscope. They were under a microscope, and people were looking to make a name for themselves by catching Lockheed or Boeing in a misstep. So.
If I could just tie it back to an earlier question, and that's exactly the reason why entrepreneurship in large companies, which have big stakes on the table, generally doesn't work versus smaller companies or individuals, mm-hmm. three guys, a pizza, and a dog that are going to try something. And if it fails, it fails. It doesn't bring down Lockheed Martin. Mm-hmm. It doesn't bring down Northrop. Or you don't have the lawyers coming in to give you approval on this and this and that. It just systematically doesn't. Because the stakes are too high, you can't take the risk.
Over here.
Hey, Connor Amesbury, freshman engineer, undeclared. I was told this is to be the last question, so I hope it's a good one.
But the last question from this side.
Oh, this side, okay.
I think we'll both be available afterwards outside.
Okay.
Also.
So this is a fairly open-ended question. What do you see the future of space exploration in the near future holding?
Well, I do believe that humankind has an impulse to explore, and that space continues to be one of the most magnetic frontiers, I think, for folks. I do believe that it is in our future to explore, as in boots on planets. I think there's a lot more work yet to be done remotely with robotic exploration. But I do think there's this inner drive in the human species to actually want to go there, be there, and experience it. There are enormous, I won't call them insurmountable, but I'll certainly call them intractable problems associated with taking humans beyond Earth and its environs, not least of which is propulsion. Then comes radiation. A lot of problems mount up when you have to take a long time to get from point A to point B out in space. But I don't know that it's necessarily going to be done by NASA. I'd put more. This is just my upbringing, I suppose, and my experience base. I'd put more bets down on NASA than I would on the various billionaire rocket boys. And probably at this stage, I would probably put China ahead of both of those entities, just the way it is. But I don't know. Do you have a view?
No, I think you said it very well. And China is to watch. They are moving, and they have a national motivation, a national will, which is not something we have in this country at this moment for this.
Yeah. Okay. Well, I want to thank you all for your attention and the great questions. Brandon, do you have some? What? You want to do them? Oh, excellent. Because you've been so patient standing here. Yes, sir.
Okay.
Hello, my name is Josh. I'm a fourth year communication studies major, so I imagine I'm a bit of an outlier here. I find myself incredibly fascinated with where the industry's going, and I was wondering if you had any advice for someone from my background, without a background in engineering, as to breaking into the industry of aerospace and defense.
You say communications as opposed to like really communicating as opposed to making radios.
Communication studies, as in, yes, oh, communication person studies. Versus
getting messages to, yeah. to stakeholders.
Oh, okay. Yeah, there's a huge set of opportunities for that kind of skill and talent in any company. And I think find yourself in either a PR department of one of the companies, get in, get an opportunity to work there. Getting communications right is very important in any enterprise. And getting the message in a way people can understand it is very important. If you just relied upon engineers to communicate what we all do, nobody would buy stock in Northrop, Lockheed, or any of the companies. So just get in the industry, get a job, get a foothold, and then just kind of claw your way up like all the rest of us.
Yeah, it's interesting because I think Ron has it exactly right. The discipline of communicating effectively, both internally in a large organization and consistently externally to their stakeholders, is kind of an unnatural act for most technical folks. And as you get into larger organizations, it becomes more critical. The interesting, and probably for you not great news, is those are not... there's not, for every 25 engineers we hire, we maybe hire one intern into the communications or business development side of things. But that's not to say that there aren't opportunities there. And I think it's just about, working your network, working your connections, taking an internship, and then seeing where it takes you. Maybe also looking around, because a lot of the big companies also use, they outsource some portions of the job. If you can find who's in their keretsu, if you will, who's in their ecosystem, you might have a better entree into that than you do go right into the front door of one of the big aerospace companies. That's my thoughts.
Thank you.
You bet. Next question.
Hi, Ron. I'm Maxim. I'm a second-year electrical engineering student. I was intrigued by when you said that even though you're very successful, you came up from modest means. And I was wondering, how did you overcome those struggles, or how did it kind of affect you? And not let yourself be defined by your circumstances.
I had parents who were pushing. Encouraging to me.
Pushing.
Pushing. I realize now that it's not an accident that I went on to get a degree, because they had always wished they could have. In their case, the depression of the 30s got in their way, and they never were able to, and their parents were immigrants from another country, and so they just didn't have the upbringing, but they kind of wanted that for me and my sister, and so... That was in my DNA that I didn't realize. So that's something that wasn't me. It was something that I was helped by. But I got to tell you something. We came to this country from Canada. But this country and Southern California and the experience we had was so wonderful that we could actually do this. I mean, a lot of countries, you can't do this.
It's the American dream.
And as many people as will, say the American dream is dead, or America is a terrible place, and it's horrible, and all. You know what? This country still has tremendous opportunity for those who want to make something of themselves, who want to do good and do well doing good. And so I would say in my case, it was just, I was just kind of motivated. I had some success, and when I had success, I was more motivated. If I got smacked around, I tried something else, and I just kept going forward. I tried to keep a moral compass of always trying to do the right thing, the ethical thing. Again, this is not something I invented. It was obviously put into me by my parents. And so if you do things, get good results the right way, and try hard, you are finally going to find a way to succeed, particularly in this country.
It must be a source of immense pride, not just for you, but for your family as well. It's terrific.
Thank you.
Great question. Thanks. Thank you all for the thoughtful questions and your attention. And we'll be outside.
Great job.
Okay?
Great job.
All right. That was fun.
absolutely riveted. I mean, what a wonderful view of such an important industry by two people who know it inside out. I mean, I'm just amazed. What a wonderful evening this has been. Thank you both. We all really enjoyed it. And now I believe there's refreshments outside, so please be sure to join us there. And of course, our two guests will be there as well. Thank you.